Now, my next guest today is a woman who works hard to keep children safe. It's Rachel Nahum of Safety Net.
Rachel, welcome to the programme.
Thank
How
you.
Are you this afternoon?
Good, thank you.
Good. So tell me what Safety Net is all about.
Safety Net is a local charity. We're based in Brighton and Hove, and we're celebrating our 20th anniversary this year. And we work to keep children safe and for well-being of children in the home, in the community, and also in schools.
So what does that entail? What sort of safety are we talking about?
There's three real strands to the work that we do. So we work directly with children and young people in schools. So some children who are watching might have done a playground buddy programme. We deliver assemblies around bullying and anti-bullying. We do lots of work around assertiveness training. And we have previously done work around personal safety and road safety, and some people might recognise the Safety Rocks graffiti projects that we've done, so they're on lots of telephone exchange boxes around Brighton and Hove. We also have a newsletter that goes out to lots of pupils in primary schools and our annual calendar as well. So that's the work directly with children. We also work with families who are going through a time of change, so it's going through some crisis in their homes, and we have family support workers working directly within people's homes. And the third strand to our work is working with professionals who work with children. So we deliver training, which is a safeguarding training, child protection training, mindfulness training, and lots around how professionals can work with the children that they work with.
It sounds like an incredibly rewarding job you've got.
Yes, it is. I mean, it is fantastic and pretty varied, and we're always kind of evolving about what next, really, around keeping children safe. I've worked at Safety Net for the last 3 years, 3.5 years, and my job has evolved. So I was family participation worker, and now I'm the online safety coordinator at Safety Net, and my job is delivering sessions around online safety. We realised there was a real gap in the market, and we're really trying to think about how to keep children safe online now.
So online safety obviously is a huge issue at the moment.
Yeah.
You know, parents very often have no idea what their children are doing when they're online. How do you tackle that? What are the basics towards teaching children to be more responsible online? Or to be safer online?
To be safe online. There are... To break it down, we do have five themes around keeping people safe online. So sometimes it can feel such a massive area. So there are five themes that we can go into in more detail. The first one is conduct. So we're finding that everybody is behaving differently online than they are in real life. So
children, that's not just children, is it?
Exactly,
exactly.
And that's lots of kind of the things that we're seeing around behaviour. And children do know how to behave. They do know how to behave in the class, in the playgrounds, and at home. But we're finding the moment they set up an account, they're behaving very differently. And that can be whether they're bullying other people or some of the language they're using. So,
I mean, I wonder why that is. I mean, a friend of mine who's, fairly elderly, certainly not a child, is the most lovely, delightful man in real life. Absolutely wouldn't say boo to a goose, really polite and everything. But as soon as he gets online in a forum, he is so nasty. How do you teach children that they need to show the same sort of respect online as they do in real life? And why do you think it is so different, the way people speak?
There's lots of reasons why it's so different. And lots of it is people have got time to plan what to say. So things, if in a face-to-face situation, if someone was being mean to you, you wouldn't really have time to think about what to say. But here we're finding that people have got time to plan what to say. Quite often when we're all online, we're in the safety of our own home. So we've got the central heating on, children have got parents downstairs or adults downstairs. I think there's something around, we're seeing loads around fake accounts and children setting up and hiding behind a mask or pretending to be somebody they're not. Anonymity that I can never say. Anonymity.
Anonymity.
Anonymity, yeah, that I can never pronounce. So we're finding that people are really behaving differently because of all of those things online. And that's really what we want to say. You know how to behave face-to-face. Model that when you're online as well.
I mean, it is very worrying if children are pretending to be who they're not online. It's a very worrying lesson in life to learn, isn't it? To put a mask up and pretend to be somebody you're not.
Yes, yeah, and I think that is, I mean, there's lots around that, and a national organisation is called Think You Know, and that's the education wing of CEOP. And Think You Know has loads of videos that can help children and parents think about how to keep safe. And on there, they've got a really great video called Lee and Kim, and that video shows what it feels like when you put a mask on. So if you put a mask on to be a tiger, how would you act differently? And if you put a mask on behind online, put a mask on and then are online, people are behaving differently there.
So, of course, it's not just about people themselves putting on a mask. It's about the person that they're talking to
exactly
wearing a mask, isn't it? That's the biggest worry that parents have, that the person that their child is talking to is not actually a child, but is somebody an awful lot older.
And that's when I was talking about the five themes. The second theme we talk about is contact. So that's who people are interacting with online. And that's exactly that. So lots of the, we know as a child protection charity that most of the grooming now is happening online. And in terms of the people grooming, they are playing the long game. So they can be speaking to someone over very innocent games like FIFA, like Minecraft, and play and talking to children for a long time so that there becomes a friendship before any offence can happen. And that is like people, adults pretending to be children online.
And it must be an incredibly worrying issue for parents. So we're going to take a short break now, Rachel, but after the break we'll talk more about what parents and children can do to protect themselves and their children online. And we'll also be looking at a conference that's been organised for next week, which you can also get involved with, and you can go along to and find out more about this fascinating work that Safety Net's doing. But for now, Rachel, thank you very much.
Okay.
Let's take a short break. We'll see you in just a couple of minutes.
Welcome back to Latest TV's Big News Show, live here from the heart of Brighton. Well, before the break, I was talking to Rachel Nahum from Safety Net. She's still with me in the studio. We're just having a chat about what can be done to make children's experience online a lot safer. I mean, I presume there's two main strands to this. There's making the children aware of certain things and making the parents aware.
Yeah.
Let's start off with the parents, because this is quite clearly a major worry for parents in this day and age. So what can parents do? Their child is up in the bedroom, doesn't really want to be disturbed, playing away on their computer, online, and the parents are worried. What can they do?
Firstly, I think the simplest thing is just really for parents to keep involved in their child's online life. So if you've got a child who loves Minecraft, and there's quite a lot out there, and your child wants to show you their creation that they have made on Minecraft, well, it's probably worth sitting down and listening to the story of their creation. The detail can go on quite a lot, but it is worth kind of sitting there, having a cup of coffee and listening. And we have found that primary school children in particular, if you ask them, have they seen something they didn't like online, a huge percentage has. And we don't really go into details what that was. And then we ask the child, did you tell anybody? And quite often, the primary school child hasn't told anybody. And that's the one thing that we really want to work with parents and professionals as well, to think around, what will you do if a child comes to you and shows you something that they don't like online? And it could be horrible, it could be violent, it could be sexual, it could be sexy, it could be anything at all. What will you do with that? And so what we're saying is everybody, all adults, should have a plan if a child comes to show you something which isn't suitable online.
And what should the child do if they're there playing Minecraft and they're chatting away to somebody that they've been playing with and suddenly an image appears that might be a violent image or
well, for the children, for the children, there's two things. So we say report using Childline. So we used to go into great detail about how you report to YouTube, how you report to Facebook, how you report there. But now Childline are keeping data of things that children shouldn't be seeing. So you can just copy the web address into a link onto Childline and report it that way. So in terms of something horrible, that's what you do. When I work with children, we always break it down into, if someone's being mean to you, do you know that child? Do you know the person? Also, do you know the person who might be being mean to you? If the answer is yes, it's someone who goes to your school or somebody who you know who lives next door who's decided to start being mean to you online for whatever reason, what would you do if that behaviour was happening offline? So what would you do if it was happening in the playground? What would you do if it was happening on your way home from school? And children then go, oh, I know what I would do. I'd speak to my teacher. I'd speak to the midday supervisor. And what we're saying is if you know the person, report it to the school or your parent. If you don't, and it's more sinister, it might be an adult pretending to be a child or anything going on, I again report to Childline.
I mean, this might engender a sense of mistrust, mightn't it? I mean, it's quite, you know, if a child likes playing computer games, yeah, likes chatting to their friends on social media, and they're being taught at school and through organisations like yours that oh my gosh, any moment now a sexual image might, yes, arrive. You know, it's very sad that we have to do this, isn't it?
Yeah, I think if I'm honest, we've gone a few years for all of us working with children, kind of pretending almost the dangers aren't there. So we haven't really had these conversations. The internet is here to stay. There are a lot of children in primary school with Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. There's primary school children with 600 followers on Instagram, uploading the most fantastic photos, and the internet is here to stay. So we are not about kind of trying to lock it down or trying to say don't go on it. They won't listen anyway. What we're thinking about is what can we do to keep safe online. The internet's here to stay. This work they're doing on there, the creations, things that they're making, whether it's music, whether it's videos, whether it's photo, anything, that what children are achieving online is fantastic. It's here to stay. And there's sort of something at the moment where we need to think around how we keep children safe online.
So there's a conference that people can go to. Tell us about that.
The conference is next week, Thursday the 25th of February, and the title of the conference is What Would It Take for Brighton and Hove to Be the Online Safety Capital in the UK? And it's next Tuesday, 9 till 2 at Brighthelm. You do need to book if you're interested in coming. And we're mixing up professionals, so we're mixing up those who work in digital media in Brighton and Hove, and there's quite a lot of companies. And we're also mixing with professionals who work with children and young people too. And if you're interested in coming, come to our website and then book on to Eventbrite through SafetyNet website.
What are the signs that parents should look out for in their children? Looking out for signals that something's not right, that they've maybe been talking to somebody inappropriate or been shown images that are inappropriate or participated in conversations that are inappropriate?
I think it's when it all goes a bit secretive, really. So we're at primary school level, children are quite interested in their parents being involved in what they're up to. So quite often they want to share photos and parents aren't that interested. We're finding that it's when it becomes a little bit secretive. So when children aren't willing to share and they don't want people to look at their Instagram accounts and things like that. So that's when it goes, that's when it's something to worry about. I think also when there's not a balance, so when people are not balanced, so there isn't kind of an online world and an offline world as well.
So this go back to the event,
yes,
for a minute. Is this something that children should attend?
It's during a school day, so at the moment, unless your school has signed up, no, it's just for adults. But there are some children coming.
And do you see a day when Brighton will become the safest place online?
We'd love it. We really would love it. And I think it's no one else is trying to get this title. So it could be something which is a real first. And that would mean everybody thinking around what, you know, are we being safe as for ourselves? Are our children being safe? And we want the conference to have a bit of a call to action. So what will I do for myself? What can you do as a role? And what can we do for the city to make it safer online?
Do you think that we use technology too much? Do you think that children use technology too much? I mean, issues like, you know, texting at the dinner table, issues like, you know, being on social media when they're watching television or trying to have a conversation with their parents.
I don't know who's a good role model for a young person. If you've ever caught the commuter train from Brighton, everyone's eyes down on their phones, playing Candy Crush or doing anything. So for me, I think if you ever go to a play park and there's a really young child saying, take my photo, put it on Facebook, I don't really know who is being a role model about coming up. I'm working closely with Jay Cooper, who's a digital entrepreneur. He's part of the Wired Sussex Network, and his company is called Good Rebels. And he's a technical company, and he's saying all of their employers are encouraged not to be on technology from 8 o'clock in the evening to 8 o'clock in the morning. And he himself is setting that boundary, so there is no technology after 8 o'clock at night. And this is someone who embraces technology. And for that very reason around overuse, and are we all using it too much? There's, you know, we charge our phones by the bed. First thing we do is check our phones before we've even got up.
I have my phone on my pillow at night. I sleep with it on my pillow. It's ridiculous.
I know. So before we've even kind of gathered our thoughts, we're into kind of what someone else had for dinner and what their children are up to and all of that. So I think with all of the overuse, I think, yes, we're all using it too much and we're not really working out how to put boundaries in place for that. I think really try and charge phones out of the bedroom and, yeah, I'll let you know how I get on.
Yeah. I mean, there's a list here of whether you're a role model for your child. For instance, with questions to ask, you know, are you texting at the table? Are you constantly distracted by your phone? So do you think there's a real case for parents to lead the way?
I think so.
To stay away from their phone and stay away from the internet a lot more than they are?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think when you talk to young people and say, they say, well, my mum never looks up from the laptop when I come back from school. You know, where are we going? And I do think that, you know, that the thing around everybody's on their phones at tables and restaurants, everywhere you go, really. So, yes, I do think we should work harder to think around that.
Okay, Rachel, thank you very much indeed
for
joining me.